us tonight, if you will. Page number 433, Since I Have Been Redeemed. We don't sing this very often. Good song. Think about the words tonight as we sing first, second, and fourth verses together.
I have a song I love to sing since I have been redeemed of my Redeemer, Savior, King.
Church tonight, thank you so much for being here and being faithful back to our evening service. And I thank the Lord for a great service this morning and a great spirit, great crowd around this place. And I'm excited about tonight. I love evening Sunday night services, and I love it. A little bit more laid back than Sunday morning, and a different message, different singing. And I love it, and very grateful to take away the whole day for the Lord. Amen. This is the Lord's Day, and I like how we call it the Lord's Day, not just the Lord's morning, amen? And good to see you back tonight. Raise your hand if you got a good afternoon nap today between services. Good, okay, so about 40%, not a whole lot. And so I am grateful I got a little bit of a nap, so I'm ready to go to about 10:30 tonight. And I'm just kidding, we're not going to be quite that long. But I'm grateful to see you back tonight. We want to start the service with a word of prayer, and we have several different prayer requests I want to mention to you this evening. And as we get started here, do you pray for Larry and Mary Lou Smith's daughter-in-law? And is she down in Florida? Is that right? And so they've been asking us to remember her. She's not doing well physically. Lord knows all about those details. So you remember to pray for Amy, if you will. And again, this is Larry and Mary Lou Smith's daughter-in-law down in Florida. And then also Buddy Parker, continue to pray for him. I've been in contact with him a couple times this past week, or once, I know, at least. And he is there in Trinity Elms, there in Clemens, with getting some rehabilitation from the knee surgery. So continue to pray for him as he continues to recover there. And then also do pray for Jeff. Jeff was here this morning. It was good to see him. And do pray for him. This is Ms. Patricia Miller's son, and so continue to remember her. And then Lawrence as well. It was good to see Lawrence this morning, and continue to pray for them and Ms. Patricia. And then also Abby. Abby is due any time now, and so we're excited about Abby and Hunter, and excited about them, and little Wyatt. And so you pray for them as just any day now that everything will go well. There with the delivery of the newborn. And then also, we want to continue to pray for Jordan Taylor's mother. This is her name's Stephanie, and she is at the Wilkes Hospital there in Wilkesboro. And do pray for her with COVID. She's kind of making some very slight improvements, and but not where she would like to be at this point. So do pray for her. I think the main issue is oxygen for her. And so continue to pray for her. I know you have been, and I know the family appreciates that. Continue to pray for them. And then also David Boles, continue to remember him. This is Miss Ida Looper's son. She's asked us to pray for him, some surgical procedures that he's had recently, and with a hand and arm situation. Do you remember that? Larry Boles, this is my dad's uncle. Remember him. It's Linda Young, still sick, from what I understand. I need to touch base with her again, but do pray for her, if you will, please. Miss Bonnie Smith, is she still at Forsyth Hospital? Do you know? Okay, do pray for Miss Bonnie Smith. She has been at Forsyth Hospital a lot this past week, and I called her, talked to her Thursday. It was the last time I talked to her. Do continue to pray for her with some heart situations, also with a kidney situation. So do remember her. And then also do remember pray for all of our shut-ins, and the list is long with those, especially with COVID right now. And they're not necessarily shutting completely, but with the situation it is with the pandemic. So let's remember to pray for all of those, and I encourage you to reach out to them. Miss Scarlett Bennett, do pray for her. She's sick today. We miss her, and so do pray for them. Miss Betty Danner's son, Mark, she wanted to meet. I spoke to her this week. She wanted me to tell the church thank you for praying for her son, Mark. He's doing much better, so continue to remember him as though, however, if you will. And then Miss Holly's family, Miss Christy Holly's aunt passed away on Friday, and do pray for her and her family during this time, if you will. And I appreciate that very much. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight and ask God to bless in a very special way this evening and help us tonight and through the Word of God, the singing. Raise your hand tonight if you have a burden to request, or you just want the Lord to speak to your heart tonight. And I always want God to help me tonight in every service. And let's pray and ask for that this evening. Father, we love you tonight. Thank you so much for being so good to us. And Father, we're so grateful for just a great spirit tonight and as well as this morning. And Father, thank you for our church family. Father, there's not a lot of places that have this genuine spirit, this love that you have so blessed us with here. And we're grateful for that tonight. And Father, we ask that you would be with every one of these prayer requests. Father, you know all the needs that we just read about tonight, many physical and some spiritual, emotional, no doubt about that. And we ask that you would intervene and work and move in a powerful way in all of these needs tonight. And Father, I pray that you would bless the singing, the preaching of your word. I pray that you'd help us to be receptive tonight. And Father, receive your word, respond according to as you work in our hearts. Maybe it's conviction, maybe it's comforting, maybe it's a challenging to do more for you. Maybe it's conforming us to the image of your son, Jesus. Whatever it may be, I pray that you do a mighty work in our hearts and minds tonight. Bless the baptisms. Father, we're excited about that after the service this evening. We ask that you bless that. May you receive all the glory and the honor and praise through everything that's said and done in Jesus' name. Amen. Choir's going to sing for us at this time. I know you will be blessed as they do tonight.
Tears to dim the eye.
Lord, that say amen tonight. I'm looking forward to that one day. Let's all stand together all over the building tonight, singing out from your heart this next song unto the Lord.
Amen. Living by faith, let's all sing together.
I care not today what the morrow may bring, if shadow or sunshine will lay. The Lord I know ruleth for everything, and all of my worry is vain. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in his great love. From all harm's way,
turn around in fellowship tonight as the choir comes down. All right, let's sing the last verse together tonight.
I know that he safely will carry me through, no matter what evils betide. Why should I then care though the tempest may blow, if Jesus was close to my side? Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in his great love. From all harm safe in his sheltering arms, I'm living by faith and I feel no alarm.
Remain standing now for one more song tonight. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. Let's all sing this together tonight, first and third verses together.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving.
Together,
Lord, prepare me to be a missionary, reaching out to those lost in sin. With thy filling, I'll be a willing missionary.
Let's Let's do that first verse again. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving.
Standing. I want us to do that one more time. I love that song, and it's got a good meaning to it. And I want you to think about the words, Lord, prepare me. It's a personal song. It's, you got to sing these songs we sing from your heart and direction to the Lord. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. You know, the Bible says our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost that dwells within us. If you're saved tonight, would you raise your hand? You're saved. If you're not, you can be. But if you're saved tonight, the Holy Spirit of God dwells within you. And He wants us to be a living sanctuary, a temple for Him, holy, tried and true with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Are you singing that with all your heart tonight? I'm asking you that. You can answer that in your heart. I want you to sing it one more time with all your heart. Let's just do the whole thing. Same thing we did. You were singing so good. And I enjoy you hearing you sing it. And let's do that one more time tonight.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for. Prepare me to be a missionary. Lord, prepare me to be a missionary, reaching out to those lost in sin. With thy filling, I'll be a willing missionary for you. First verse again. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Amen. You can be seated. Thank you so much for singing out. And you say, Pastor, I am not a missionary. Oh, yes, you are. We are commanded by Jesus to go out into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And if you believe the word of God, say amen tonight. You know, that's the word of God, to go out. And God may not call you to Africa. God may not call you to Europe. God may not call you to Australia or some of these places around the world. Some of these places that we have missionaries that we're thankful we support them. But we can go across the street. Amen? We can go across the street. But God may have not called you to go to plant churches out west like Philip Moore, our revival preacher who just preached for us back in March. God may not call you to do that. Now, I believe He does still call people to do that. Amen? But God has called all of us to be a witness. Amen? For the Lord. And we can be a missionary around the corner, across the street, at the grocery store. And I encourage you to grab one of these as you walk out tonight. As you walk out the entrance door here, you'll see these outreach cards, gospel tracts. You call them whatever you want to. They're hanging there on the wall as you walk out on the left. And there's two different kinds right now to choose from. They're basically both the same. All of our tracts, gospel tracts, outreach cards, again, whatever you want to call them, they all have the gospel presentation on the back. Tells somebody how to be saved. Has all of our church information on it. Tells them how to get to a good church. And I believe that we ought to have a church connection with the gospel. If somebody gets saved, then they need to be discipled and baptized. Amen? And that's three part of the Great Commission is teaching them and baptizing them and training them. And so that needs to be connected to a good Bible-preaching, Bible-believing church. And so I'm going to encourage you to pass these out like hotcakes. You say, well, I don't want to waste money. Friend, if you pass one of these out, you're not wasting money. And the Bible says, God says, my word will accomplish that which I please. And you know, the gospel tract, sometimes you pass it out and you give it to somebody. Sometimes people are reluctant to get it, especially during COVID. Some people may reject it and say, no, I don't want it, or whatever it may be. Somebody may tuck it away in their coat pocket and not see it again till next year, okay? But again, God can go through this, through His Word, where you and I can't, okay? And it can go in their car, can go in their home, can go in the refrigerator, and so many different things. And I tell you what, one of these days maybe we need to have everybody stand that has been reached maybe by a door hanger, an outreach card in this church. And it's amazing what God can use you to do as a missionary from Temple Baptist Church in Lewisville and Clemens and King and Davidson County, wherever you live. We have people that drive all over this place, all over the area. And so wherever you're from, Yadkin County, King, on and on, wherever you live, let's be a witness for the Christ. Amen. And to pass these out as you go. All right. And then also we have several announcements real quickly for you tonight. Don't forget about after the service this evening, we'll be receiving an offering. If you didn't get your tithing offering in this morning, be sure to do that tonight. And the tithe is not mine. The tithe is not yours. The tithe is the Lord's. Amen. So let's be faithful to give unto Him. And then also tonight after the service, we're going to disconnect in this room, in this sanctuary. And then we're going to reconnect over there in the Heritage Hall. And I love that remodeled building. Is so beautiful, and we've had so much work that put into that, and I'm so grateful for that. And so I'm excited about the many, many, many purposes that Heritage Hall will serve for us down through the many next, I don't know how many years till Jesus comes back, and we're excited about that. And so it's have a waterproof floor, and we'll be able to use that for, again, many, many purposes. The only thing really that we have left in there to do is we're putting can lights in there, replacing those chandeliers, and those will be dimmable. And so that's about the only thing we have left. Other than that, it's ready to use now, and so we're excited about using it tonight. So we'll be disconnecting from over here after the invitation. We'll be reconnecting over there. We'll give you about five minutes or so to get over there. We have chairs laid out for everybody. If you're not comfortable sitting in the chair, you can stand. We're not going to be in there long. We have four young people to baptize, and I'm excited about that. Amen. And I'm excited about what God is doing in this place. And we have another family that's planning on joining the church next week, and excited about that. So a lot going on, and I'm glad to be a part of a place that God is blessing. Amen? And let's continue to pray and ask Him for His blessings. But that'll be after the service. And then Wednesday night, don't forget about Wednesday night service, 7 o'clock. Lord willing, we'll be back in our series on the Book of Revelation teen program, also, and Kids for Truth program, all at 7 o'clock. So keep that in mind. Let's be faithful to the house of God. And no Wednesday nights. Sometimes it's hard. It's difficult. I know you work. I know some of you get to church and you haven't even had supper yet. And so, but let's be faithful as much as we can on Wednesday night, again, as much as we can. And then also, a spring golf tournament, that'll be this Saturday. And I'm excited about that. We've had several sign up. And if you haven't signed up and you plan to do that, the deadline is tonight. And so please help us with that. We're looking forward to that at Tanglewood this Saturday morning. And we'll have more details to come. We'll probably reach out to you individually by way of text or so forth to let you know the details and so forth. But again, deadline tonight for that. Then also the mother-daughter banquet. There's a sign-up sheet for that also in the entryway. That is May 6th. And I can't believe that next Sunday is going to be May. Think about that. My mom said the other day, she said, we're going to be at Christmas before long. And that's about the truth. And oh my goodness. Mother and Daughter Banquet, May 6th. Sign-up sheet is out there. There's a lot of people already signed up for that. I love to have 50 or 60 ladies. We probably already got close to 40 or so already signed up for that. I'm excited about that. And so Miss White from Freedom Baptist Church, she's the pastor's wife there, Freedom Baptist in Rural Hall, I know she will be a blessing to you ladies, and I'm excited about that. So keep that in mind. That's for all the ladies, not just mothers and daughters combo, but all the ladies, and I encourage you to attend that. Sign up, please, so they can have enough understanding for refreshments and other seating arrangements. And then also the teen and young adult fellowship cookout is going to be Saturday, May 15th at 5 o'clock at my house. Mi casa, su casa. Is that right? All right. I'm excited about that. And I say that jokingly. That's not true, okay? Mi casa is not su casa, okay? It's not your house. It's my house. So please remember that when you come on the property. And I'm joking. Some of you are going to take that literal, okay? And I'm joking a little bit. And I'm just excited because I can speak a little bit of Spanish. But anyway, oh, my goodness. But anyway, for real, we're going to have a grand time. That'll be the May teen activity. And I want to welcome everyone. We did the Young Adult Fellowship. We started that probably 2 years ago, roughly. And the Young Adult Fellowship, we have the teen program, of course. That goes to about 19, roughly 18, 19 years old. And then we all have the Young at Heart. And the Young at Heart, of course, has kind of been out of commission last year because of COVID. The Young at Heart goes from 50 up. And so we established the Young Adult Fellowship for ages 19 to 49. And so we found out really quickly that ages 19 to 49 have a lot going on in their lives, okay? A lot of them have children and a lot of things, but I want to encourage you to make plans to be with us. We're going to be hosting that, of course, at our home. We live 45 seconds from here. We'll get all the address and that information to you soon. And if you've been before, you know we have a ball. And what we do is, you say, well, Pastor, it's probably real spiritual and everything at your place, isn't it? No, it's not. I promise you. Okay, we do try to keep it spiritually from in certain aspects, of course. But we have a grand time. We'll have barbecue. We'll have a big game of big ball volleyball. One thing I love about big ball volleyball is it don't matter if you're 8 years old or 88. You can play, and I enjoy that. We have a ball, just a sweet time of fellowship. So keep that in mind, if you will. Mark your calendars for that. Then Ladies Missionary Prayer Fellowship will be hosting a spaghetti supper May 19th. That's a few weeks down the road, but we're going to good announcement. There's a sign-up sheet there in the entryway for that. That'll be prior to our Wednesday night service, and so keep that in mind, if you will. Again, sign-up sheet for that, so keep that in mind, if you will, tonight. All right, take your Bibles, if you will, please, to the Gospel of Mark tonight. This morning we're in the Gospel of John, and then tonight we're in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7. Mark 7 in your Bibles tonight, and excited about talking to you for just a few moments on the subject that the Lord laid upon my heart. Just could not get away from it. And I'll tell you up front, it's extremely simple, simple thought, but I hope that Lord will use that to be a blessing to you tonight. Miss Kelly Honey is going to sing for us, and it'll be a blessing tonight, and then we'll get into the Word of God.
Trust in Jesus, just to from sin and self to see.
Amen. If you enjoyed that, say amen. I love that song. Doesn't get any better than that. You know, we trust Jesus as our Savior at salvation, right? But then the Bible says the just shall live by faith. It doesn't stop there. We trust Jesus as our Savior, but then we continue to trust Him through life's the ebbs and flows, the ups and downs of life. We have to trust Him and cling to Him, rely upon Him. And that's a little bit really of what we're going to be talking about tonight, trusting in the Lord. So Mark chapter number 7, and again, thank you so much, and I am so overwhelmed and at what God has done for us in the music program at this church. I'm very grateful and thankful for the many people that put it together. The choir, Brother Holly, does a phenomenal job, instrumentalists and everyone, and I appreciate everything that God uses and allow God to use you. I'll get it right in a minute. Mark chapter number 7, verse number 31. It's so good to see some of the families here tonight with some of the young people who are getting ready to get baptized tonight. We're excited about that. Thank you so much for being here. If you're visiting here with us, we're very grateful to have you and trust that this will not be your last time. Hope you'll come back many, many more times. Mark chapter number 7, look with me please in verse number 31. Mark chapter number 7, verse number 31. The Bible says, and again, departing from the coast of Tyre and Sidon, He came unto the Sea of Galilee, this is Jesus, through the midst of the coast of Decapolis, verse 32, and they bring unto Him one that was deaf and had an impediment in his speech, and they beseech Him to put His hand upon him. And He took him aside from the multitude and put His fingers into his ears, and He spit and touched his tongue. I want to pause right there and say, you know, we don't always understand everything that Jesus did or why He did it and other things. If God spoke creation into existence, then certainly Jesus could have spoke as He did at other times and caused people to be healed. But Jesus did this heal this man. In verse 34, it said, and looking up to heaven, He sighed and saith unto him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. And straightway his ears were open, and the string of his tongue was loose, and he spake plain. And he charged them that they should tell no man, but the more he charged them, so much the more, a great deal, they published it. Verse number 37 is what I'm interested in tonight. It says, and were beyond measure astonished, saying, He hath done all things well. He maketh both the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak. And of course, He did many, many other things. Can we say that statement there in the middle or a little past the middle way of verse 37 together, where it says, He hath done all things well. Can we say that together? Let's do that. Ready? Begin. He hath done all things well. Let's pray. Father, we love You tonight, and we're so grateful that we can look at so many things and look at how You do things perfect, with completeness. You do all things well. And I'm thankful that we serve a perfect Savior. We serve a perfect God, a righteous God, who does things, who allows things in every aspect of life. And Father, You do all things well. You've never made a mistake. You never will make a mistake. We love You tonight. And I pray that You'd use the simple thought tonight to be a blessing and encouragement to Your people. I pray that You'd use me as a simple vessel tonight that You might use. And we'll thank You for all that You do in Jesus' name. Amen. So after healing this man from being deaf and also from the impediment in his speech, he could not speak, he could not hear, and Jesus heals him, the witnesses, those who saw it and experienced that, by the way, I'd love to be a fly on the wall during those times, wouldn't you? And be able to see everything and experience all of that. The witnesses were astonished, and they replied that statement, He hath done all things well. All things well, speaking of Jesus. And I just simply want to restate the fact that God does all things well. And when you leave tonight, I simply want you to remember that statement. He does all things well. And we talk about well, we're talking about perfect. We're talking about complete. Everything that God does, He does it well. I want to take you just briefly back through Scripture in the Old Testament, primarily some of the New, about what God has done by way of introduction. Then we'll get to the simple message tonight. I want you to remember creation and how God did has done creation well. I'm reminded back in Genesis chapter 1 and verse number 31, the Bible says, "And God saw everything that He had made." And by the way, we do believe that God created the heaven and earth. Amen? And we do believe that. We believe that God made us. And God saw everything that He had made. And behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. God did creation well. God did creation. I look out. I love going to the mountains. And I love seeing the rolling hills. I've been out to the Rocky Mountains. I've had the privilege of being out there. And I love, Ray and Sandy, where you guys are from, and out in Colorado. And I love to see those mountains. And I've got to see a little bit of creation in my day. I've seen Niagara Falls. I've been up there a couple times. And I love to see the mountains, the lay of the land, the Appalachian Mountains. I love the ocean. I love the coastline. I love that. I love to see so many things that God has created. And I have to look at that. And when I look at that, I have to say, God has done all things well. Now, we've messed things up as sinners, haven't we? We've messed things up. But we have to understand God has done all things well. The animals and the animal kingdom, and how all the animals, just how everything works out in a miraculous way. God has done all things well. Not only creation, but I want to remind you that God's covenants, or His promises that He's made with man, are done well. Can I remind you of the covenant that God has made, or did make, with Noah, and how God told Noah, "Noah, I'm going to set a rainbow in the air, and to promise you that I'm not going to flood the earth again." And you know, scientists can say this is how it happens and this is how it happens. Well, friend, I believe that God put it there. Can I get an amen? And God made a covenant there with Noah, and God has kept His promises. We're talking about God does all things well, and how creation was done well. The covenants, or the promises He's made down through history with man, He has done well. He did the covenant with Noah well. He did the covenant with Abraham, was done well. Remember in Genesis chapter number 12, when God told Abram at the time, before He changed His name to Abraham, remember, He said, "I'm going to make you a nation, and your seed is going to be like the stars of the sky. Your seed is going to be like the sand on the seashore. It's going to be innumerable." And can I say that God has done all things well? He's kept His covenant with Abram. And then also, just going down through the Word of God, God's covenant with Moses, and all of the things that He did there, and through the law and so forth. God has done all things well. I thought about the covenant He made with David, and the promise that the promised seed would come through David in his lineage. And I'm reminded of the genealogy we find in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter number 1, how Jesus Christ came through the seed of David. It's in there. The Jews are very peculiar about their ancestry, and it's all outlined there how Jesus Christ came through the seed of David. And of course, one day He will rule and reign. Amen? We're going to get there not too far from here on the Wednesday night and be talking about that. But God's covenant, His promises that He's kept with man, with individuals, with peoples, with nations, God has kept those. He's done those well. Can I say the promises that He's made to you and I, directly as His children, as New Testament church members, He's made promises to you and I. And can I say, He's done all of those well. He's never let me down. When He says, "I'll never leave thee, never forsake thee," when He tells us He will do things for us and so forth, and His grace is sufficient, I guarantee that nobody can stand up and honestly say, "God has failed me." Not one person. Because God doesn't fail. We fail Him. But God does all things well. I thought about creation. God has done creation well. God has done His covenants, His promises with man well. Thirdly, by way of application, or by way of introduction, God's coming for salvation of man was done well. Amen? In Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 12, the Bible says, "But this man," talking about Jesus, "after He had offered one sacrifice that was himself, of course, for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. In the Old Testament, the priest didn't sit down because the work was never done of sacrificing the lamb for the sins of the people. But Jesus Christ, when he sacrificed himself, he, of course, was buried. He rose again after 3 days and ascended back to heaven. And the Bible says, sat down on the right hand of the Father, signifying his sitting down, signifying that the work was finished. Confirming his statement on the cross, one of the seven sayings of the cross was, it is finished. And Jesus finished our payment for our sins. Amen? And he did that well. He did that well. Salvation is done well. God does all things well. Lastly, I'll give you, by way of introduction, God's canon of Scripture was done well. Canon, of course, a sacred portion of books, and God's canon of Scripture was done well. The Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21, for the prophecy came not, I want you to listen to this very carefully, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man. People in the old, David, who God used to write Scripture, Moses, who God used to write Scripture, and so many others who God used to write Scripture all throughout the Word of God, they didn't do it according to their own will. It says, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. We believe in the inspiration of Scripture, amen? And we believe the fact that God breathed, God moved men of what to pin down. And as it be, and I've used this illustration so many times, but I want to make sure that we remember that, because I believe there's an attack on the Word of God. And so it would be just like if Tootie Farrington were to come up here on the platform. You don't have to, Tootie, but let's just say he did. And Tootie says, Pastor, I want to write a note. And I said, okay, Tootie, then here's a pen. And he said, no, I want you to write it. And I said, are you sure? And he said, yes. And he said, I want you to write down, Dear David. I don't know what you're going to write, David, but we're going to find out. Dear David. So I write, Dear David. He said, David, I just want to tell you how much I appreciate you, and you're a good brother in Christ, and you're a hard worker, and I'm going to give you $200. Whose words are those? Are they mine or Tootie's? Who's writing them down? But whose words are they? They're Tootie's. I'm writing them down. That's how the Bible, we understand. Men, and people are going to say, well, that's man's words, and that's man's understanding. That's man, and it's just a bunch of man's words. Well, listen, friend, God used men as an instrument just like he uses you to sing and bring honor and glory to his name, and just as much as he used you to teach that Sunday school class and witness to your neighbor. God uses you, and God used those men as well to pin down Scripture, and they're not men's words. God just used them as an instrument, but they're the words of God. Can I hear an amen right there? And God's canon of Scripture was done well. And I'm thankful we have the Word of God for us this morning, or excuse me, tonight. So God does all things well. Jesus does all things well. You will find, if you will inventory the life of Jesus, if you'll search God, you will be just like Pilate and say, I find no fault at all in him. No fault. No fault. He does all things well. Can I bring this to the message tonight for you and I? Listen carefully. We do not always do things well. This is a heart searcher. It's a quencher. We've got to search our own hearts. God does all things well, but can I be honest with you, Pastor Boles doesn't. I make mistakes constantly. If you don't believe it, ask my wife. She'll tell you. God does all things well, but I don't. And because we do not do things well, we do not always do things well, may we trust in God who does do things well. And I want you to notice three things tonight, and I want you to turn quickly, and I'll be honest with you, the message is very short. Take your Bibles to Psalms chapter 40, and I want us to look at a man in Psalms chapter number 40, who God used to pin this down, his name was David, and God used to pin these things down, who experienced a God who does all things well. And can I say that God needs to be personal to you? You need to experience in your life, teenager, In your life, junior age, young person, in your life, mom, in your life, dad, in your life, grandparent, how God does all things well in your life. We can't keep riding on piggyback of our aunts and uncles and our grandparents and our moms and dads. We need a generation to rise up and say, I know God as my Savior, and I'm trusting in Him on a daily basis, and I found that He does all things well in my life. It needs to be a personal. This Christianity needs to be personal. It needs to be real. Amen? Psalm chapter 40. Is everybody there? Say amen if you're there. Look at verse number 1. Let's read it. David says this, very familiar passage of Scripture. He says, I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. Wonderful text of application for salvation. Verse number 3, and He hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Verse 5, many, O Lord my God, are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to usward, they cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. We'll stop there. I want to give you 3 things. If we, because we do not do all things well, may we, number 1, request things from He, God, who does all things well. Notice again that statement of verse number 1, that last portion of that, and heard my cry. Well, if God heard David's cry, that means that he was crying unto the Lord. That means he was calling out unto the Lord. Maybe there was a problem, there was a difficulty in David's life, and he needed the Lord's help, so he cried unto the God who does all things well. And can I encourage you with this tonight? May we request from the Lord things that we cannot do on our own. May we request from the Lord things that we cannot do on our own. Raise your hand if you have something in your life that you would like to see God do, and you know in your heart and mind you cannot do it. Anybody like that? And I believe that we all ought to have a prayer request like that. We ought to have something so big that we desire that really only God can do it. I have things on a regular basis that I pray for our church, and I realize that within our ability financially and every other aspect, it cannot be done. But with God, all things are possible. So I'm just going to keep asking Him. I'm just going to keep asking Him because He's going to do it well. So request from the Lord when we cannot do alone. But what about this? Why don't we request from the Lord things, not just that we cannot do alone, but why don't we request from the Lord things that He can do better? That's hard. You ever have a problem and you can fix it? We're just going to get my torch. Go get my sledgehammer. I'll knock that door down. I'll fix that. And you might can. But if you're like me in everyday life, and you try to go fix something, anybody ever made something worse? You're looking at the king of worsening problems. Anyone ever ate shoe leather? I can't even speak. Leather. Anyone ever ate shoe leather? Put your foot in your mouth? I am the king at making problems bigger and more difficult. Somebody's telling me, I was teaching a Sunday school class a couple months ago, and I was digging a hole. A big hole. And somebody said, Pastor, bury the shovel. Because I was making it worse and worse and worse. But requests from the Lord things we cannot better. We need to get to the point when we understand in our individual lives that God does all things well. I don't. And there are things, by the way, that God intends for us to do ourselves. If there's something, God has given us a brain. Some of us have to look for that and find out where it's at. Now, I'm just joking tonight, of course. But God has given us a brain. God has given us wisdom. God has given us the ability to ask for God's wisdom and His direction, His guidance. And there are things that He expects us to do on our own. But I want you to understand there are circumstances in life, and a lot of times they come more often than we realize, in situations that I could fix this. I could fix my children. I can fix this marriage. I can fix this problem in the church. I could fix this problem at the workplace. I can fix this problem with my neighbor. I just got to go over there and tell them. I'm just going to go set them down. And sometimes that is in order. But God wants us to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. We can do this and we can do that and we can do this on our own and we can tear down the door and we're going to get through it. But it's very possible we're going to make a bigger mess than what it's worth. And so why not request from God things, yes, that we can't do on our own, yes. But why don't we also request God to do things that He could do much better than we can, because we know that He does all things well. There's been so many times in my life, and not just as a pastor, as a Christian, you understand that I'm human. I'm just like you are. I have house problems. My dryer and washing machine, they seem to never want to work properly. When one quits, the other one runs great, and then the other one decides to go boop, 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 you know, and wants to die on us. When you got three kids, when you got five people in a house, you need a washer and dryer to work all the time. And it seems like if it's not this thing, it's this thing. You know, I've got problems in my life, and I'm not talking about fixing that. I'm just using these silly illustrations. But you understand there are circumstances in our life when we cannot necessarily fix it. Maybe it's a spiritual, maybe it's emotional, maybe it's a mental, maybe it's something that we understand that maybe I could say something, maybe I could do something and fix the problem, but wait a minute, why don't I trust the Lord with it? Why don't I request God to work in the situation before I meddle in it? Because He does all things well. And I've experienced a lot of times in my life, and I'm not talking about the washing machine situation, I'm talking about their situation in my Christian life, when I realized if I mess with this, I could probably fix the issue, the relationship issue, or whatever it may be. But if I take it to God in prayer first, soak it in prayer. I'm talking about soak it in prayer for a week or two before I ever even approach the matter. I find out that God has a way of softening hearts. God has a way of mending hearts. God does all things well. And I find out when I soak it in prayer, when I request things from God, I find that this problem is solved before I even have to deal with it. And that's not always the case. But I found it to be the case enough to know it works. And I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you need to fix in your home, marriage, children. I don't know in your neighborhood, in your workplace. I don't know what needs to be done. But I know that I have a God that does the impossible. And I know I have a God that does all things well. He doesn't make a mistake. He doesn't make a mistake. Never has, never will. So why don't we trust Him with it? So may we request from He who does all things well. Number two, may we rely upon He who does all things well. Notice in verse number one, He says, what is the first part there? He says, I waited patiently for the Lord. Oh, raise your hand if the word patient just gets at you, because it's hard to do. All right? And we're all impatient to some degree. There's some people that have patience, and God bless you. Let's spend some time together, okay? But we're all impatient to some degree. We want it now. We live in a fast food type society, and we want it now. But if we're going to request some things from God, and we're going to see God intervene and do some things for us, do some things that are impossible, then we're going to have to rely upon Him, and reliance with the Lord and on the Lord takes patience. When I have a situation and I say, Lord, I could think I can fix this, and God says, and the Holy Spirit says, well, you can, but you better let me do with it first. Then I have to take my hand off of it and I have to wait upon Him and give Him time. The Bible says so many times to wait on the Lord. I love the verse, you know it, in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall do what? They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Why? Because you're going to find out when you wait on Him that God does all things well. You renew your strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. You're going to keep on going like the Energizer Bunny. I don't know if that thing's still going or not. Used to when I was a kid, it was. But you're going to keep on going if you'll wait upon the Lord, you'll request Him and rely upon Him, but it takes patience. Sometimes when we request things from God, we say, God, I'm going to put this in your hands, but we have to take our hands off of it. Reliance on the Lord takes patience. Reliance on the Lord takes a spiritual perspective. In verse number 4, it says, blessed is the man that maketh the Lord his trust. We have to understand that God is in control and God can do things we can't. And there has to be a spiritual mindset about that. And lastly, and I'm done, may we rejoice in who does all things well. Look in verse number 5 at what David the psalmist says. He says, many, O Lord, my God, of thy wonderful works, which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to usward, they cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. If we would truly think about all of God's blessings and we would stand up, each and every one of us, around the auditorium as we do in Thanksgiving time and have testimony service, it's not a bad idea to have that every once in a while between Thanksgiving each year. But have a stand up and thank God for what He had, and if we would truly have all the time in the world, we'd be here for days. Because all of the wonderful works that God has done. Listen, friend, I can rejoice, not in the situations of life, the circumstances that surround me, not in the crazy society that I live in, but I can rejoice in the fact that God has done all things well, regardless of whether we agree with them or not. God has done all things well. And I finish with this. When we request things from God and we rely upon God, then we will, no doubt, rejoice in what God does because He does all things well. He hath done all things well. Look at this man. He's doing everything well. And He's our Father. He's our, should be our best friend. He's our leader. He's our guide. He does all things well. He'll never steer us in the wrong direction. May the Lord help us to request things from Him, trusting Him, wait upon Him for those things, and then simply find ourselves, we will find ourselves rejoicing in He who does all things well. You want to be astonished like these people in the Gospel of Mark chapter 7 of all that Jesus does, and feed the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, heals this man, being able to, deaf and can't speak. If we want to see God do great things, let's request Him. Let's ask Him for things. Instead of trying to do it on our own, let's rest in Him, rely upon Him for it, and then we can rejoice that God does all things well. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes tonight. Bow our heads and close our eyes. Musicians are coming tonight. In just a moment, we're going to stand all over the building. If you're saved tonight, the altar's open. I want to encourage you to come. If you need to use the altar, it's open. Let's stand together all over the building with heads bowed, eyes are closed all over the building tonight. If you're not saved tonight, it'll be a wonderful night to trust Christ as your personal Savior. I don't know what the needs are in your life, but we'll talk to you one-on-one about trusting Christ. Would you come tonight? Brother Holly's going to sing one verse for us tonight. Would you come tonight with heads bowed and eyes are closed?
His name Think is about wonderful. The words tonight. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord, He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord.
Let's sing it together. Words are up here on the screen.
He's the great shepherd. Rock of all ages, Almighty God is He.
Father, we love you tonight. Father, help us to see things in our lives. Father, whether we agree with them or not, whether we realize it or not, you have done all things well. We love you tonight. We simply praise you and worship you for all that you have done and who you are. We love you tonight. Help us to go forth this week excited and spiritual fire for what you've done in our hearts, and help us to be a witness and a light for others, for you and to others. Father, help us to realize that you do all things well. Help us to confide in you and help us to rely upon you with that. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you, church. We're going to disconnect in here, and I want to encourage everybody to stay. We've finished up just about 10 minutes earlier than what we normally do. And again, I want to encourage everyone to make their way over there and to be a part. Come and just see the new building and its remodeling, and you will be, I think, thoroughly impressed and excited about that. And so everyone, meet us over there. We will start in 5 minutes from now, so it is 7:35. Yeah, go ahead, brother. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Real quick.
We're
going to
sing together.
Yes.
No, I'm just kidding.
Man.
No, we're not going to do it.
I'm good with
no,
that,
no,
brother.
No.
Teenagers, real quickly, I need everybody, if possible, if there's a 1% chance that you're going to be able to go to the Youth Congress this year, I need you to sign up, if you will. We've got to get registered for that real soon. So, again, if you sign up, it doesn't mean you're locked in. We just need an idea of who's going, so please do that. Also, this coming Wednesday night, my wife and I are going to be out of town, but Houston and Lakin are going to be taking care of team meeting this coming Wednesday night. And she told me today, she let the cat out of the bag, they're doing homemade ice cream Wednesday night. So y'all may not let us back in there when we come back, but they're going to have homemade ice cream and some fixings over there. It's going to be an exciting time, so please make sure you're there, teenagers.
Amen. All right, I don't know. We might have church over there Wednesday night. All right, so I'm excited about that. Okay, so keep all those announcements in mind. I'm sorry, brother, I didn't let you do announcements tonight. God bless you. I'm sorry, brother. All right, our disconnect over here, 5 minutes, about 7:40. We're going to start over there, all right, and in the Baptist Street. So everybody make your way over there. All the doors should be unlocked here, so keep that in mind, all right?